she'd come home talking about this one girl who's like her mortal enemy. And one day I was like, what did she do? She's like, one time she said I had a nice, she complimented my haircut, but I felt it was like sarcastic. Like she was like a backhanded compliment. Fuck that bitch. You're like, what? That's what this is all about? This 5 year beef or whatever you had with enemy number one?
Yo, what's up, Square Pimp Brigade? On this episode, we have comedian Anthony DeVito. He's here. We discuss what it's like growing up without a father, being in the mafia and not being available to you. Growing up with only women. Dante being friends with Patrice. We're talking about old stuff with me and Patrice, old Patrice stories. And, you know, not to fight your emotional battles the same way you did when you were a kid. Really good show. Good dude.
Yeah.
Funny dude.
Great show. Plus, we go over to Patreon with them. It was so fun. We kept going with Anthony DeVito over at Patreon, where we do all our bonus coverage, bonus episodes, and we also do listener mail. And if you want to support the show, go over to patreon.com/manschool202. Sign up and support the show. It keeps the show rolling. And also, Dante does consultations. Dante, how can they get a hold of your consultations?
DanteNero.com. Click on consult. Most of the motherfuckers on Patreon have done consultations. But
that's true.
If not, man, if you got a friend that's fucked up, you can hit me. You know,
that's right. And if you want consultations from me, you can find me via email, advicefromharry@gmail.com. And we can set up rates and stuff. So if we've ever helped you, you know, consider coming over, supporting the show. Enjoy the show, guys.
I'm not an alpha male. I'm not a beta male either. I'm just a better man. Better man. Well, put your happiness first, because if you don't, they won't. Yo, what's up? What's up? Welcome to Man School 202 GYBB. Get your balls back. WWDD, What Would Dante Do? The Sexual Revolution is being podcasted, and I am excited. Now, I know I've said that 500 times before, but this time I really mean it.
Nice. Finally. Finally, one.
Wow, man. That's so
honored. Genuinely be excited about.
Because we have a special guest. I've also said that 600 times before, but this time I mean it.
My God, Dante, are you taking all the honesty out of it? Hilarious.
First and foremost, I got to talk to my partner in crime. What's going on, motherfucker? Harry Terjanian in the building.
Hey, man. Hey, listen, Dante, I'm out here living a life that people wish they could have dreams about. That's how I'm doing.
People don't even dream about your
life.
They
don't even have, they wish they could have a dream about the type of life I lead.
A lot of dudes dream, they have imaginary friends. I know a crazy dude has an imaginary friend that doesn't like him. I
was boy.
Like, you created this motherfucker. You could have made him like you.
He's not talking to his imaginary friend. He's got beef.
Well, his imaginary friend's not really talking to him. He's like, this guy's boring.
So, did they fight over an imaginary chick or something?
Well, the guy who is the real person, he just don't get laid. The imaginary friend does, too. Mm. So, you know, it is what it is.
We've been there.
We got our special guest. Let me introduce him. Let him get in on the fun. Coming from parts unknown with shadows and pieces of gay dudes in his fridge.
Hey, man, some of them are straight, too. You know, I'm not like I'm a equal opportunity murderer.
Aren't we all gay a little bit? Just a little bit. Come on. I got pink Crocs.
Somebody's been watching the Dahmer documentary on Netflix.
Yeah, it's good. Fucking give it up for my boy, good friend of ours, Anthony DeVito. Yo, what up, baby? What's going on?
Nothing much, man. I'm very happy to be here, man. Thanks
for having me. See you. The shadows is very menacing.
I tried my best to be more powerful. I tried to exude more power than I have. Try to intimidate you a little bit.
Even the shadow on the side of the face, it reminds me of the picture of my face on the side of the truck, like the half shadow I do.
It's the way they used to light monster movies in the 20s. It's kind of from below, like, well, a Dracula.
He got the cool half face.
This is true.
Drama. The old school was just a flashlight underneath Bela Lugosi's chin, but whatever. You know, you gotta do it. Yeah, what up, brother? How are you, man? Good to see you, bro.
Yeah, man, I'm good, man. I just, like I was saying, I just, back in town, back in the city, I was in Scotland for like a month doing the Edinburgh Fringe Fest, man.
And I'm going to add, like, how was that? Like, we wasn't talking about it off air, but.
Sure, yeah, we'll try. Yeah, we'll try to be like, oh, interesting, actually, Dante, bring it up. Wow, fascinating, man. Yeah, man, it was brutal, man. It was, the sensibilities are different.
Right.
And like, so like we're saying, like, yeah, they just like, you know, they don't experience comedy the way like American audiences do. Where like you're kind of engaged with comedy over there, man. Comedy is just presented to you. You just kind of sit back,
like a movie.
And you judge it
like a movie in a way.
Very much like a movie.
Now, do they laugh or they don't laugh?
No, man, they don't laugh at anything. They barely giggle, and then afterwards they'll be like, "That was really good," or like whatever. But it's like,
"Wow, you were amazing!" Right?
Yeah. Like, where were you? I looked in your face, man. I looked in your face for an hour. You didn't budge. Get out of here.
No, what's funny? Because you know, my son. So I have I don't know if you know what was going on with me, but I have woman from England tracked me down from the podcast. Okay. And found me, stole my sperm, and then I have a son who's 3 years old, and then she stole my sperm and told me she wanted to live in Brooklyn in a brownstone and just raise a great kid, and I gave her all of that, and she was like, changed my mind, and she snatched my son and took him back to England. So
wow.
Yeah, don't look that. It's not that bad. I mean, it's...
Yeah, you seem okay with it. You're smiling.
You know, I mean, you didn't see me the first day. I was a little tense
for right. a while. It wasn't like there weren't days of not smiling. I think it's just, you know, a couple of rough days, which is understandable.
Maybe like six. Sure. Listen,
I lost my favorite watch and I was bummed about that for like, I don't know, a week.
Yeah, right. Yeah,
you know, it happens.
Yeah.
Patrice used to have a joke. He used to tell Vaughn, you're my third favorite thing. He goes,
you're fifth on my priorities or something.
No, it was third. It was my job, comedy, my mother, you, and then my favorite leather jacket.
Yeah, that's what I was gonna say. I thought you were gonna say hats, but
well, that's for later. Which actually, you know, I'm the one that fucking hooked them up with the hats. People don't, like he went out. He was looking first. He was wearing alligator shoes and suits. Man, he went through that,
right.
And I was like, and then he was buying gators, and he had these hats. And I actually took him over to check out the Jews on Coney Island Avenue. So that
that's the store name, the Jews. Did they just put that on the market?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I don't, you know, I'm not judging. I just want to, you know, that's
what they're calling it.
Trump says the blacks. There's my African Americans, all of them, right there.
Where's my African American? Where is he? Where's the one guy? Where is he?
There he is. Look at him.
Look at him.
He's my favorite black.
Being my favorite one.
Over there just being black and stuff.
Favorite black.
It's actually two, because it's also the black dude with the ponytail. Trump's blacks for Trump's, with who he's clearly has a record and got out, you know, he got let out because of some shit that Kim Kardashian did or whatever. I don't remember exactly, but he's they always put him right behind the podium. I took him to see the Jews, and they, you know, like my dad was born 1920.
Mm-hmm.
So he was like old school, where you would wear a fedora, but you didn't just get the, like, you know how goofy dudes just kind of get a hat and they just put the, you had to steam it.
You had to have everything good to go along with the hat.
Like, you had to literally take the hat, right? My father used to take a pot of water and a can of pineapple juice, empty can of pineapple, and cut a hole in it. It would sit the can in, and then the steam would come up, and then you would steam it and crease it and break it down. You know how when you see a hat, it's really...
Wow. This was before people had TikTok and stuff. So there's a lot of time to fill. with activities and stuff.
But you can't have your skimmer and it be not broke. Like, come on. You know, that would be like, let me give an analogy. Kind of like most comics now, just, you know, very bland and whatever the fuck it is, whatever the kids like today. But he would break the hat down. So I took him over to the haberdashery and he cut the hats down. And then we would bring it here and I would steam it for him and starch it and put it on. And you know, it's got the right crop to it. Anyway, sure. Anyways, a little funny, something else I taught him, that I get no credit for.
True.
We've been doing this.
I'm already replying to the hater comments on the YouTube page as we speak.
Why, don't worry.
I'm typing time. No, I'm just anticipating the hater comments.
Yeah.
I'm preparing all my replies the hater comments on the YouTube section.
Yeah.
Anytime you bring up
how
Patrice.
Could you say that? Could you say that?
Anytime you dare to say Patrice was not perfect or had some flaws, even though Patrice O'Neal told everybody he was not perfect. And had many flaws.
And the fact that he was 437 pounds, never perfect, really? All right, him and Lizzo. So,
yeah. And that's your boy, but he had flaws. As we all do.
Yeah.
Yeah. And one day I remember going to his house, him coming out the shower, and I was like, oh, it was frightening. And he said to me, he goes, I think the same thing every time I look in the mirror. I don't know why these bitches keep fucking me.
Oh man, that's great.
So Edinburgh, because I went to England and England's scene is a little like, they have some funny, like it's a little sharper. The first time I went and did shows there, it was which was about 3 or 4 years ago. Like you said, very, you know, just meandering along, just kind of like white girls in L.A. Like, I was in the mall with my mom and we were shopping, right? And I'm like, I hang out with my mom all the time. And then she was like, the guy at Abercrombie & Fitch is hot. And I was like, Mom, you're a whore. And laughter.
Yeah.
Insert laughter. So
it's like they're like filibustering. You know what I mean? Like in like D.C.
Oh,
like, it's crazy.
I have to tell you this. So, you know, Al Franken is doing comedy again.
Yeah, I heard. He's been around the past couple of months, right?
And Sherrod called him filibuster Franken.
Yep. And I like Al. I like Al, but he I saw him once at the Salad.
Listen, great senator.
He is actually funny. He ain't 40. He doesn't got 45 minutes yet. And that's let's just put it that way.
Oh, he's got 45. Just not 45 you want. You know, he's reading Green Eggs and Ham on stage trying to filibuster the room.
Filibuster Franken is here.
Filibuster Franken. Only Sherrod. Only fucking Sherrod.
Anthony, Sherrod. Well, I love Sherrod. Sherrod's the best. Sherrod Small is still the last of the rock stars.
Last of the rock stars. Just living that rock star life like no other comic.
Like
no other
comedian ever. Sherrod, I've been on the road with Sherrod. Guitar. And it's great. It's great because I just hang with him, even though I don't drink or whatever. So it's almost like I'm shadowing him and like watching a documentary, and it's the best. Anthony, what was the show in Edinburgh? You were doing a show. What was that show about, though?
So my dad was he's a made guy in a crime family, and he died.
Which family?
I can't say, man.
Yeah. You can't.
Unfortunately, but he died.
Okay. Did you get whacked?
For legal reasons, copyright.
No. Yeah, man. For just for my mom's own, just like peace of mind for her.
Might be going to Genovese later.
No. Okay. All right. Say hi to my uncles, man. Say what's up. But he was a made guy, and he was killed. But I didn't find this out till I was like 18, and then I learned more about him at 30. So I was honestly like,
you didn't think it was funny that he had you had 100 size 42 regular suits in the same color. You didn't think that was funny?
Yeah. No? My mom's like, here's what your dad left you. And they're just a bunch of crisp suits and hats. And I was like, I wonder what kind of guy he was. I don't know.
But, so did you know him? Did you grow up with him or no?
No, I didn't grow up. He died when I was 7 months old.
Oh, so, wow.
Yeah.
You never got to experience him at all.
No, not at all. And my mom was very nervous, like, about just, I think having me know anything, not so much that she was afraid of, like, she wanted me to sort of have a life outside of that and just be safe and, you know, whatever.
Of course.
That's all that happened. And then I didn't know. I found out I was 18. I was playing basketball on the blacktop. There's a guy that looked a lot like me. I never seen him before. And he was like, your last name is DeVito. I was like, yeah. And then he's like, I'm your cousin from your father's side. So I went home. I was like, oh, mom, I met my cousin from my father's side. And
she was like,
exactly. Like real dramatic, like Italian woman. She was like, I need you to sit down for this. Like it was like a whole thing. I swear to God. Yeah.
She was like, Anthony. She sounded like, yeah. Eat your mother. You sound like the Omen. What was it? No, the Exorcist. Me, Jamesy.
Yeah. Yeah, she had a pot in her hand. She put it down, and then she went and told me. But
hold on, I have to stir the gravy. I'll be right back.
Yeah. Not now. The gravy is almost ready. So she's pissed that like it interrupted the sauce.
It happens.
But yeah, so I was doing the show because I was like, I wanted to talk about him on stage. I had something sort of like I found out I had this like heart thing that might have been fatal. So I was like, you know, kind of when you really like face the prospect of death, you're like you kind of want to unburden yourself of your secrets. And I never talked about him really to anyone except like close friends. And I was like, I kind of wanted to tell not even so much his story, but like kind of what my mom went through and everything that like she did for me to like kind of have this life of my own. So I was just doing it as like jokes in a stand-up set. Like I was like, oh, it'll be another chunk. And like audiences were like, this is way too much. Like on a late show, like, what are you doing? You know,
It got too intense. You're saying like for comedy wise,
it seemed like the subject matter was a little too complicated to unpack in just like a stand-up set. And you know, I've only done stand-up. I've never really fancied myself like a theater person or anything like that.
Right.
So, but like people were like, I think you should center, like write this as a whole thing. So I did. And I was doing it, you know, throughout the country in the city and stuff. And people were like, you got to go to Fringe. You got to go to Edinburgh with this. This is like the show that's like perfect for there.
For that. Right.
For that. And then I went over
it was
there.
Like, no, it's not. Like,
they did not care for it over there in England.
No, they did not.
I bet you they liked it.
Overnight in England. Edinburgh's in Scotland. Excuse me.
Yeah.
But they they really liked the storytelling elements of it and like the compelling elements of it. But they don't really see jokes the way we do, I think, in like what jokes can do. You know what I mean? Like where jokes like alleviate a lot of trauma and make it lighter. They really want you to hold on to your trauma, you know? And you're like,
they want you to be miserable.
Yeah, they want you to be miserable in it.
Scottish people want you to be miserable. That's weird. What if I would ever make you think that at all?
They look at bagpipes as like enthusiastic music. It's like, why would I think?
So like it was just a little light bagpipe, whatever.
Yeah.
But
so, man. So the sense of, it's interesting, man. Like the sensibilities, you don't really expect it, you know, because you know you comedy all over, and then like the sensibilities of like kind of like a little bit of a pretentious like theater crowd. Like I was even getting feedback that they were like, yeah, your accent is a little too. And I was just like, what? I didn't even know I had one. You know,
when you went out there, you was like, oh, let me tell you about my
mother. Yeah. I was like, buongiorno, everyone. I didn't make it the pasta for you.
They would have understood that though.
Anthony, do you do the thing in the show where you turn around and you put a different hat on to play each character? Put a different, and then a mustache.
Like Gorshin. Like Gorshin. It went something like this.
I think it might just go a little something like this. I have a series. I have a bunch of hats on a coat rack, and I put one on for the different things.
The different characters and whatnot.
Two of my closest friends is Joe DeRosa and Keith Robinson.
Sure.
And we call each other up and just trash each other probably once a week for like an hour and a half. And we will trash other people. And, you know, Truck Hudson, I'm also really good with Truck. Yeah. And Truck called, it was Dean Edwards. Sometimes we'll bring other people in if we need more people to beat up on. Sure. And Keith called Dean Edwards Rich Little.
Oh, that's old school reference.
Man, there's no one who gets greater joy out of just that than Keith. It's like, it's so fun to be around, you know?
Yeah, and then nobody does it anymore. I was I was at Stand Up New York Saturday.
Yeah.
I'm with Courtney B.
Yeah.
And Christine Meehan and little E-Man Morgan.
Yeah, yeah,
and,
yeah, yeah.
And, you know, John, the little Filipino dude.
Yeah, the
Filipino
guy with
gay dude.
Yeah, he's got different eyes. Yeah.
Yeah, you got the fucked up eye, right? So he was filming.
Fucked up eye. What kind of thing is that to say?
It looks like somebody poured milk in it. Like he's got milk. He's got a milky eye. So he
he has a dairy eye, man. So
you just had to go. You just had to go, John with the eye, and everybody would have understood. There's no other John. You didn't go, John with the eye. You know the fucked up eye. Oh yeah, fucked up by John.
When I met him, I met him, and he was like, "Yeah, I'm gonna be booking here." And I go, first of all, what's going on with that right there? Can we talk about it? He was like, I was born that way. I was like, all right, now we can move on. I'm not going to act like you don't have a milky witch's eye in your head. And I got to keep acting like, Harry, you've been doing this podcast with me for not. I must really. Am I cutting deep, Anthony? Because he usually
No, it's just.
I thought you were being nice, to be honest. Yeah.
I mean, I'm not saying I've seen it. I've seen it, and you've gone harder, but it's just.
So he was filming a thing.
Fucked up.
He's trying to film a show.
It's just the phrase "fucked up eye," with the way you say it, because you didn't say it as an insult. By the way, you were just saying as reference, so Anthony knew who you were talking about.
Yeah.
It wasn't like you were breaking balls. You know, like tall John.
Like, you know, like white dudes drop the M-bomb. You know, the niggas up the block, the nigga family up the block.
That's what caught me. It's just like, you know, John. Oh, yeah, now I know.
So he was filming something.
Right.
I didn't tell you this, Harry. He was filming something with some horrible comics that he, because he has all these horrible comics, young comics that he's. Yeah. So the first thing, I didn't tell you this, Harry. Hmm. So it's a three, he's filming, it's a 3-hour show. It went from started at seven. Went up at 10:38. So 3 and a half,
I went up.
And he goes, they're really tough. But he asked me to close it out so people would go home happy, right? So he comes up, and Harry, you know I can pull it out. Even three, I would say I pulled an eight and a half out of that show.
Which is incredible.
Pretty fucking good after 3 and a half. But he says, yeah, they're really beat up because he hangs out with all these young comics and they kind of look up to him. He goes, yeah, you know, you might want to go with the working the crowd work because they're really beat. I go, have you ever heard heard of the movie Blindside? He goes, I go, if you ever tell me what the fuck to do on stage, that's going to be blindside too, because I'm going to punch you in your dead eye. You're not going to see it come. I promise you, don't ever fucking tell me what the fuck I'm supposed to do on stage. Right?
Man, what if you hit him in the eyes and then his eyes were fine after that?
If you fixed it.
I would just open a spa and just pop dudes in the eye. Better than laser surgery, right?
Oh, my goodness.
I go up, I come on stage, right? And he goes, yeah, we're going to film this thing and then we're going to try and sell it. And if you want to really get a good laugh, check Instagram, check the lineup, right? It was hilarious that you think you're going to sell this horse shit. like selling hot dog water, like old hot dog water in plastic bags, not even jars. And, he goes, yeah, I spent 20 grand on this. And then we're going to, I said, do you realize you could have had, you could have bought a new eye, right? Oh, with 20 grand.
Like I go, the best you eye, got, like a great one.
You could have got the one with the bionic, the zoom, infrared, fucking.
Could have had a RoboCop eye.
Right, yeah. Yes, you could have got a RoboCop. 20 grand.
You could be solving crime, John.
You could have got a predator eye where he does the thermal signature.
A universal soldier eye.
They look at you. They look at you, and then he can tell your waist size on your pants, and you.
Right. He's like, "This is the date you're gonna die."
Oh god!
But it's still book comedy, though. That's the thing.
And every all the other comics were just like, "Not." I was like, "This is so much fun!" Like I laughed, and it was just, you know.
Yeah, I don't.
Should have been there.
Yeah, I think you know what it is. It's like, I think it's the people like you, like Keith, man. You just, there's so much joy when doing it. You know what I mean? Yeah. That it's like, you can't really get, it's a different tone. And I think that's like what a lot of like.
And I don't think people get offended. They, you know, you get smacked. I mean, if it's on you.
Yeah. It's,
you know, it ain't great all the time, but it's still funny.
Yeah.
True. Hey, Anthony, I want to ask you about what it was like growing up. So you don't have a dad. Has that affect what you do growing up, dating life, the whole thing? Like, how does that?
Yeah, like, man, I mean, it was all women. You. So for me, it was like, it was not only no dad, like my house was like my mom, my grandma, my great grandma, my mom's youngest aunt. So it was all women.
All Italian women.
Any sisters?
All Italian women. What's up?
Any sisters? You got sisters too or no?
I don't have any siblings. So it's just me. Nah. I have four aunts. None of them have kids. So it's just me. Wow. It was just my uncle was the only guy, like, and he was like, my uncle was, you know, he was kind of like real. What's up?
No, that was your mother's. He wasn't.
Yeah, my nose?
No, the Maloiki, the Maloiki.
The curse. Yeah.
Anyway, go ahead.
Yeah,
I'm
man.
Sorry. I learned that.
No, man. Dante, you're good, man. You're all right.
All right, thanks, man. Can't win them all.
No, it's okay, man.
Thanks for your support, Harry. You piece of shit.
I don't know what the fuck you're doing. Exactly. What do you want me to give you on that?
You should have went with it. You don't know this when they talk about
the Maloiki.
The Maloiki.
And then when they made men, you go, who's that? You know, you do that.
Man, everyone knows more than I do because I was kept.
Right, so you were so sheltered.
I was so sheltered from it.
You couldn't even watch Godfather. You ever see Godfather?
Dude, I only saw Godfather 5 years ago. I was not allowed to watch it, man. I swear to God.
Oh, so your mom kept you away from like every aspect of that lifestyle. Yeah. The other.
Yeah. Does she at least make sauce? No, she probably don't even make sauce. She makes pot roast.
That's so funny. That's how deep she went with it. We just had gefilte fish every night.
You know, that's a good joke. You can have that.
That's funny.
But so you grow up. You're in a household with four women or however many women that's in there I worry that's I feel like it's good to have a male influence if you can. Not everyone does, but how does that impact it? Like, how does that impact how you deal with women, dating, the whole thing growing up with that, surrounded by women?
I mean, I would hear women out a lot, and there would be a lot of like sometimes I mean it's good and bad because like I was very used to like listening to women, like all those kind of
perspective.
Things. Yes, have that perspective. Yeah. I will say, I'm not confrontational, and I think that's like that's a thing that's something like I would love to have a little bit more of in my life. Whereas, like, I feel like I apologize because like women apologize all the time.
Yeah,
So I apologize.
They just don't mean it.
Right. It's obligatory. Yeah. It's like they're just this reaction. They're like, you do get so
quantity.
Sorry.
You do get quantity with women as far as the apology goes. The quality, like, you know, you got it. Whatever. It is what it is.
They use it too often. it's like when you're like playing a video game and you use the thing too often and it drains the guy of all its power. It's like it's meaningless. Yeah. But
use it, that low kick. They just keep hitting that low kick, click, 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 click.
They sweep too much.
So they're apologizing all the time for everything you're saying and that. So you feel like you're not confrontational because they weren't confrontational.
Yeah, I think so. Like my grandma would be, but it's like a different form of being confrontational. You know what I mean? Like it's a lot of like
passive
muttering,
aggressive and
a lot of passive aggressive. Yeah, it's a lot of just like threats that aren't exactly facing the issue. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like Like anytime my grandma would get mad, she would threaten to sell the house, but she would never be like, this is why I'm mad, you know?
She just said, clean up your toys. She was like, right. No, right. We're going to be homeless.
I'm homeless. I'm a 9-year-old out on the streets like Oliver Twist.
Please, sir. Please, I would love some coins to buy some raspberry dressing.
Yeah. It's a funny you say that, because I'm fucking, I think I'm a little hyped up, Harry. I don't know why I'm hyped up.
No?
Oh yeah, I had a triple espresso. Okay. I didn't know you could order that.
Damn.
So, Anthony, you know I do consultations. I don't know if maybe you don't know that, but I'm like anybody in the comedy community has ever gone through a breakup or something or whatever. I personally take our responsibility for Pete Davidson and him smashing all that prime puss. I remember walking him through his virgin, like when he was a virgin, the first girl, and he used to call me up for chick advice and all kinds of shit. Him, Giannis, and Christy Stefano, and Lenny Marcus, and the list goes on. Anyway, but what I find is that guys who don't have that male figure, like, so you learn the social dynamics from women, you know, and you don't, so like, for instance, like, again, get ready for these comments. Patrice was his mom, single mom, right?
Right. Yeah.
And so when he would get mad at me, he would not call me and tell me, "Yo, this bothers me."
He would give me the silent treatment.
Yeah. And he would,
and then you have to figure out what's wrong.
Right.
Yeah.
And I'll be like, I haven't heard from you in 3 weeks. What the fuck? What's wrong with you?
Right.
Yeah. Well, you know, somebody told me something you said. I go, but why didn't you ask me?
Right.
Yeah. I was like, I would have told you. He go, yeah, but then you would have just probably lied about it. And I was if you don't have that.
Oh, no. I remember you told me this story. Hold on, Dante. Because he goes, then you would have just said you were sorry about it or whatever.
That's... I didn't mean it. And you're a friend, and I, you know.
Yeah, of course.
I'll give you this.
Up, whatever.
He almost said he didn't know if he could be friends with me because of the fact. So were you around for Todd Lynn?
I saw Todd Lynn. I saw him when I was like, I'd go to the Cellar before I was doing comedy.
Okay.
I wasn't.
So
really
anyway, a guy that no guy deserved death more than that guy. Worst human being ever. I have a few comics that actually, we used to go to dinner to celebrate his death, that he was gone. What a piece of shit. I'm back where, but there was a time where he got sick and he was going blind and stuff. And I helped him out and I, you know, would pick up his wife and his kid from, and then naturally after that, he fucked me again after that, which is, you know, plus he borrowed rent money from me. I never got that $900 back. Wait till I see his son. I'm going to take $900 out of his son's ass. So I remember forgiving him when he actually had a conversation and I forgave him. Plus, he was like really, really bad place because he was dying and shit. He had pancreatic cancer, some shit. Sure. And Patrice said to me, I don't know if I could even if we could be friends, because how do you you hated that guy so much and then you forgave him? And I was like, yeah, but I don't understand. Like, why does that make you not be able to? But it was just for him. It's like, you know, if I apologize, if you and I have a problem and I apologize and you believe it's sincere, you either accept it, or if you don't accept it, we keep it moving. But that I was sincere, or you accept the apology and we move on, which is a very chick like thing to do, is to
hold,
accept the apology and then be like, I just don't know if we could be friends. I just, OK, like.
From my experience, right, and this is mostly in the workplace, like I worked in a rail shipping yard, right? So it's like guys.
It goes Harry name dropping again.
Yeah, you know, listen.
Rail shipping yard, you think that's a name drop?
You know, I mean, you guys, you know, not everybody can live that lifestyle. You know what I'm saying? that's not for everybody. But for someone of my stature, you know, you wind
Stalin
up in
and
rail,
profiling, right?
You know, you're living it up at the rail.
Harry used to
yard.
Walk in and go, "I've spilt more liquor than you bought, paid for."
Yeah. And so, you know, guys fight in that situation, right? It's a lot of like, it ain't always the most intelligent dudes, or it ain't always the most sophisticated dudes. And there ends up being fights, sometimes fist fights. And then everybody settles the beef eventually, and you keep working together. And then there's people who fought that are friends. You get over it, you shake hands, and then somebody helps somebody else out. It's like, "Hey man, thanks for that." You move on. Like, I've seen literal fist fights. And then at the time I was dating somebody, she's like, she'd come home talking about this one girl who's like her mortal enemy. And one day I was like, what did she do? She's like, one time she said I had a nice, she complimented my haircut, but I felt it was like sarcastic. Like she was like a backhanded compliment. Fuck that bitch. You're like, what? That's what this is all about? This 5-year beef or whatever you had with enemy.
Don't
number
do that.
One?
Anthony and Sam Morrell haven't talked about his beard in years. He don't even play that shit anymore. He's like, he's still holding him a grudge. But go ahead.
But it's just a weird perspective of like, you know, you're able to fight. Guys are kind of able to fight and like, if, you know,
let it go
and move on, as opposed to like, it's almost sort of once you cross a line, they never look back the other way. Some I find with some women. But Anthony, how did that affect like that type of mentality affects how you deal with relationships? Did it affect how you fight with your girl or whatever, or whoever you're with?
Do you have a girl now?
Yeah. Okay. We've been together for a while. We've been together just about 10 years.
Wow.
Yeah. So she's really good about like,
that's a typical Italian engagement, by the way. You're waiting 10 years before you. And then,
I don't know if she's the one.
Yeah, she didn't pass through all the trials yet. There's like a series of things she still has to exceed at.
Some with a photograph and blood and a dagger. Yeah.
It's all Sarah.
She's not a friend of ours yet.
Yeah, the Pope needs to come for a weekend, feel her out. Like, there's all kinds of stuff. Like, flights arranging and stuff has been difficult. But, yeah, she's very good at, like, conversation, like, almost, like, right away. So that's
white great. Girl, Latino, what?
She's white. She's half Jewish. So I think that sort of like affects, like, once something is bothering her, it's out right there, which is nice. So that's kind of forced me to be like a little bit more like, like if I have an issue,
confrontational.
Like, yeah, a little bit. Yeah, exactly.
She's setting the tone.
She's setting the tone a little bit, which is good because like, I had a tendency to like more harbor feelings. But I do think like, I was like playing sports, I think, helped because you're just around other guys.
You learn how to be a guy.
You kind of learn how to be a guy, and like, you're kind of weirdly figuring it out together. And like, yeah, man, you're on the basketball court. Something happens. It's like, yeah, you might fight. And then it's like, you're playing together with that guy the next game. So it's you kind of wrap it up more quickly. Whereas, women, like I watch my aunts in like blood feuds with each other for like years. And you're like, what is all this?
Because they stirred the sauce with the old, stirred the old spoon from the old sauce with the new. I told you that, Harry, I cooked, I was a chef in an Italian restaurant. Hmm. This dude that used to run Mama Leone's, and they would make the sauce for the week.
Right.
So it'd be one of those big jail pots, you know,
gigantic ones.
Yeah. And the boat oil, you're stirring it with the boat oil, but he did everything. Like, he would get a case of tomatoes and cook them down. Like, he wouldn't even get canned.
Nothing. Nothing.
Which is why the
liquefy the tomatoes.
Business, because he was just, everything was so high end because he was from New York. And I went to college in Wappinger Falls with all, there was all these hicks up and up, and all they wanted was pizza and meatball, you know, Chef Boyardee, they're good to go. And he was making rigatoni with the three cheeses and, a cream sauce. And I would tell you this, Harry, I took the spoon from the old sauce, stirred it in last week's sauce, and he threw out
the whole
10 gallon is a spackle can, right? So 30, 40 gallons of soup, threw it out. Cause I stirred it.
Yo, 40 gallons, just throwing it on the floor. Like, it makes a big splash. Like, that's 40 gallons.
my top floor of my house, you could cover the whole floor with 40 gallons.
40
you
gallons of sauce.
Sheetrock you could do with four spackle cans full of...
We're talking out. Load-bearing walls, yeah.
Yelled, and then I think he's still yelling at me. I mean, he's also a fucking idiot because it was last week's salt, like...
Yeah.
But he was just like, you contempt. It's just... It's done.
That's
so, you know,
I don't know if that's an Italian thing or just a mental disorder thing. That might be like a Howard Hughes OCD sort of thing, as opposed to an Italian thing.
He's Italian. He could tell you they're very particular.
Very particular about. The different spoon. I've never heard. That's like another level. I mean, Italians are super particular about sauce and all those things. But like. A spoon that was used on another sauce.
But you got to look too. It wasn't like, why would you have, you wouldn't have another sauce. You know what I mean? Like sure. In a home, like we were.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
So for him, like, so why would you have two jail pots? Like you have 2 gallons of sauce in this one and a brand new 40 gallon. And so you wouldn't have it. But I mean, he was just like, you know, just throw it out. I'm like, dog, that's like $800. With the sauce, like,
yeah, cooked,
but insane. But they're just very particular.
Yeah. Well, Italians too, it's just like, there's just too prideful, man. You know, like, there's just like so much of it.
Did that does that affect the way you, how does the Italian thing affect how you date? Like,
I mean, I don't know. Like, you know, I don't know if it really does, you know, or
what
maybe
about approval from your mom?
Approval from my mom, not really, because my mom was a little bit like my mom would overdo it, like in terms of like baby me and like be like you're the best at everything, this and that. So I would kind of tip the scales the other way. So like I'm like crazy hard on myself because she never was. So that's like the part where it gets to me that's like detrimental to me. Mm-hmm. Where I'm like I overdo it. Like I'm like a horrible father to myself. And because my mom was this like doting woman, you know?
Right.
Super doting.
I think what's interesting is a lot of times I'll talk to dudes who didn't grow up with a dad and they haven't learned, like, because the social dynamics of it is grossly different. Now like I grew up with my dad, but my dad used to do youth work.
Right.
And so he was a dad to everybody else in the neighborhood except for me. Right. But I did have a male model to you know, you when you think about what you think of a man is, it's your dad. And if your dad's not there, you know, you're piecing bits and pieces together trying to figure it out where he was. And then my dad was a dude, right. Like, you know, like real guy. I mean, he was also born 1920 when you could beat your women with a stick. Less blood, no thicker than your thumb. So I mean, I guess
the government gave out sticks. Yeah.
But the thing is, one time he beat her with last week's stick, and
he had to get another wife.
He goes, "We got to do it all over again." She's like, "What?"
I mean, the whole thing is ruined. Got rid of my mom. But yeah, it's you know, that's a funny thing. So the adjustment that you made, you know, being really hard on yourself, was it a personal adjustment because you were trying to be a better version of you, or what was the dynamic?
I think it was kind of a balancing thing, because I knew that what my mom was saying, although it was supportive, like it wasn't wholly accurate, you know?
Yeah.
Especially because like this would happen a lot with sports, and sports is just math. You know what I mean?
Right. You're like, either good or you're not.
Yeah. The ball goes in or the ball doesn't. But my mom would sort of like, she would, you know, she'd throw out excuses like as to why. She'd be like, the sun was in your eyes, the ball was deflated. Like, so these things. So you're at some point, like I was like, her reality is not real.
Right.
So I had to counterbalance, and that counterbalancing was like ended with me like being super hard on myself.
Can I say this though? To kind of have that insight, right?
Yeah.
Is super self-aware as a kid to see that insight and then make an adjustment. I get that at in terms of our emotional growth, right? So this is an interesting thing. I did a consultation with a guy. I've told this story a couple of times, so I'll make it really quick. I did a group consultation with a guy and a girl. The girl he was dating kept cheating on him.
Right.
He was 27 years old. She was like 21, 22, hot stripper. She'd go to these strip and she'd hook up with her girlfriend's guys and other girls. So he had this consultation with me, and I said that, you know, we make these decisions about how to solve our life or how to cope with the trauma, the emotional trauma, right? And so one of the things that I find when women are super, super promiscuous is, so she got molested. She was getting molested by her dad from the time she was 11. I said, did you ever been molested, if you don't mind me asking? She goes, yeah, I was 11. From 11 to 16, her dad was touching her and whatever. And so you're in a situation where you perceive intimacy as painful because it's from a guy who's supposed to keep you safe, but it's there's this contradictory kind of thing. So as a young kid, your way of solving that is, okay, intimacy hurts, so what I'll do is I'll separate sex from intimacy, and then I'll just have a lot of sex. So it's kind of like if you got arsenic and you take an eyedropper full of arsenic and drip it down your throat, you die. Whereas you take that eyedropper of arsenic and you put it in a baby pool, you dilute it. So the more sex you would have, the less painful it is, because it's just sex. What does it matter?
Right.
Which is why she, you know, even though she loved this dude, she had learned this way of coping with this trauma.
Right.
The problem is she was 11 when she came up with this solution.
Right.
And so then when you're, I mean, I don't know, how old are you now?
40, man, but you're right, though.
So that was the solution you had at the time, which is still ridiculously insightful and aware that this is something that needs to be, I'm not going to be right if I don't have this balance, but it's still, the degree is degree, like it's the intensity is set by you at what? 10 years old, 15 years old.
Yeah, man.
And then you got to kind of revisit what, like, okay, do I really need to be this hard with my, I mean, I figured out a way to survive and to balance things, but I probably wasn't the best person at 12 years old to, so let me readjust my solution at 40.
Yeah.
But we don't do that.
No. You just do what you did at 12. That's what I'm doing in, you know, that's why I'm in therapy once a week or twice a week, whatever it is.
You should have asked me. I'd have told you what it was.
Yeah.
Because it's, if you ask yourself, is it really reasonable for me to be this hard on myself?
Right.
And you just say it out loud.
Yeah.
You go, what am I doing?
Of course.
This is the first time I've ever done this and I'm not perfect at it.
Of course.
Why do I feel like trash, you know?
Yeah. And you start, like, you'll go back to the, like, whatever those, like, harmful thing, like, whatever was, like, the manifestation of, like, you being mean to yourself. Like, in my case, like, it would be, like, I used to, like, I would hit myself. You know what I mean?
Really?
Yeah. Like, I would, like, I'd punch myself in the head as, like, sort of this, like, physical representation of, like,
internally. Seriously bang yourself in the head. Like,
yeah, man. Like, I have stitches on the top of my head from, really? Like, banging my head against the wall. Yeah, no, man. I was, like, very, like, it's funny in this way of, like, that's how good of a mom I was. My mom was. That's, like, how bad I needed to be as, like, a father.
Or how bad your mom was, because.
Sure.
Balance is what's important. My question is this: so when you, in your past, when you dated, did you date really shitty chicks who gave you a rough time? Or, because I would think that would be, you know, a lot of times when we're hard on each ourselves like that, we date people that give us the outcomes that we think we deserve.
No, that never happened. Like, I mean, that did, it happened, but I don't know that, like, she wasn't really like that. She ended up cheating on me, but it wasn't like she was bad towards me in the relationship.
Did you have a lot of girls that cheated on you, or
no, it was just the one, but that was like, that was probably like the seminal relationship in my life in college. that was like, that was like the first time where I was like open enough to give myself, you know what I mean? But she wasn't cruel to me on like a daily basis. That was just something that was like, okay, we weren't right for each other. And then it worked out that way. But no, I've kind of, the women I've dated have been like representations of like the women that raised me. I don't think it's like any secret. Like,
we all do that. Yeah. We marry our, you know,
yeah. They're like
so very nurturing, super this.
Nurturing, like characters, like my family, they were all like women who were characters and they were funny. Yeah. So like I gravitate towards women who like are that way. So like,
I mean, that the same way we talk about the representation of manhood is, which is what you come, what you're trying to become.
Sure.
Womanhood is your mom.
Yes.
Like yes. That
100%.
I got to do my neighbor, his mother is a demon. And he women he date just treat him like trash. They're like evil to me, and he can't pick. You know, anything not that is not womanly enough for him.
Right.
You know.
Yeah.
Whether it's because subconsciously he's seeing that as the parameters. But so the women you dated were like your mom. Did you have you got a big body count? You got a high body count?
No, man, it's embarrassing. I mean, embarrassingly low, but like more so like I was more quick to just like fall in love with a person and then be with that person for a long
time. Got you.
And like my trajectory was like, I dated this girl in college, was my first love. We dated for like 3 or 4 years. And I was like, so like, you know, I grew up in North Jersey, and like, you probably don't understand too. Like when you grew up in like sort of like a somewhat like blue collar, like a little bit rougher area, and you kind of have this like artist, like somewhat sensitive brain about you,
wow,
you feel super isolated. So then like, I really, you know, I wasn't really giving, especially like, man, Italian women in Jersey, like that, they're like some of the meanest, like, you know, like that's brutal, man. Like I would be like, hi. And they would be like, fuck you. And I'd be like, all right. Like, you know, so I fell in love with this girl in college. We dated for a couple of years. She cheats on me with my best friend. So from there, I was more just like, when after you're being cheated on, like you're hurt so badly, you can't give yourself to someone who you love 100%. So you find people that you like, if they break up with you, you'd almost be okay with it as a means of protecting yourself. So like I went from there to this other relationship, which was safe. But after a while, I was like, this isn't right what I'm doing to her. So I got out of that and then met my fiance now. And that was kind of scary at first because I was like, oh, I love her as much as I do my college girlfriend. But this has worked out so far.
That's cool. Sure, I'm going to tell you something interesting, but I'm going to do it in the Patreon. If you can hang out a little bit.
Yeah,
let me real quick. What do you got going on other than the show that they hated in Edinburgh? What's the name of the show?
My dad isn't Danny DeVito.
Okay.
I got a stand-up special out on my YouTube channel called Brain Noise that you could watch. Just go to youtube.com/DeVitoAnthony.
Cool. And any social media you want to drop your show?
For sure. You can follow me on Instagram at comedian Anthony DeVito.
All right. Harry, talk to me.
Yo, you could check all my social media at Harry Terjanian. And I'm also doing relationship consultations, which has been great. If you need any sex or relationship advice, just find me via email, advicefromharry@gmail.com. And then we can talk about rates and what I can do to make your life better. And also join us over at patreon.com/manschool202. Right now, we're going to continue our conversation. And I'm curious what Dante is going to tell Anthony, which is very interesting. We're doing our bonus coverage over there, patreon.com/manschool202. And we're also doing listener mail. So come over.
Y'all all know I do consultations. Go to DanteNero.com, click on consult. You can get me. I'll fix your life. Everything else, Google me, bitch. You know what it is. Y'all know how to find me. GYBB, get your balls back. WWDD, what would Dante do? The sexual revolutions being podcasted. I love y'all, man. We'll see you on the Patreon side. Please.